Lord, I'll never turn back. I know more go down, go down among the flower yard, and perhaps you will find him there. Along home, I know my Lord, no more my Lord. Lord, I'll never turn back. I know more, and I found in him a resting place, and he had made me glad. No more, my Lord. No I know more, I know more, I know more, no more.
From, you know, a very young age, even before all of the things that one would consider to be sort of landmark events in my life happened, I'd always felt like an old soul.
I felt like I needed to do everything as if I was going to die at 21. So I was moving too quickly through things without as much care as might have been necessary. And I had aspirations to work in fashion, I had aspirations to work in design, to work in arts, graphics, media. I didn't know patience. I didn't know the beauty of taking your time. When I was still in my teens, I was doing commission portraiture for a while. And in 8 to 10 hours, you learn so much about a person from not the things they say, but from the things they don't say. You get a sense of a human being beyond what someone would reveal through dialogue, by how they sit, by how they behave, by how uncomfortable they get in certain situations. And I loved that. I loved getting to know sort of what isn't said about people. But often the most beautiful shots that we get are not poses, but the moments in between. They're those moments where you're just adjusting something and they're natural. You're just resting your head on your hand. The normal things can be really beautiful. In music, it's the same as well, you know. You learn the basics, you learn chords, you learn the circle of fifths, you learn theory. But those don't mean anything. It's not until you reach another person that you can fully experience what it is to express yourself. It needs a catalyst. It needs a muse.
The rain came down in sheets that night, and you and I stared out to the left and to the right.
Her lyrics remind me a little bit of Emily Dickinson's poetry, full of dreams and full of stars and paysage, landscape, and intimacy and no, I think she reminds me of Emily Dickinson, who's the greatest American poetess.
Clouds raced out across the autumn sky, and you and I fumbled for a way to say goodbye. Strangers, weren't we scared to look into each other's eyes?
When you grow up poor, you don't know anything else. We lived in the tiniest place. My mom and I shared a bed till I was about 13, 14. In a tiny little room. The kitchen was connected to the living room, connected to the bathroom. It was like one room plus a main room, and that happened to be the dining room, but it was eating in the kitchen, you know? We were happy to have a roof over our heads because it was our own. You know, we didn't owe anybody for it. It was ours, and more importantly, hers. But she worked three jobs to get it.
When I was a little girl, I was raised by my grandmother. And it has its ups and downs. But the downside rests mostly on the fact that as you're approaching fundamental youth, she's approaching senility. And it's kind of like being in the same taxi, but going two completely different directions at the same time. It's very difficult. So every day my grandmother would try to find something for me to do, and inevitably she would default to the modern day definition of raising a child, which is go watch the television.
She wasn't tender the majority of the time. You know, she wasn't soft-spoken. She said what needed to be said, and she said it with a sense of conviction.
So she put me down in front of the TV. They had about 56 channels, and the only problem is that Grandma didn't know that cable was invented. So on every channel, all it was... And I was a really dull child, so until about the age of 12, I used to think that it was snowing everywhere, except for where I was. And then eventually, she picked up a VCR, and she thought, oh, okay, we'll do something new. So she came up with this idea of watching movies. Great in concept, but one fatal flaw. There was only one movie. So it wasn't much better. And one day I got really tired, and I said, you know what, Grandma, I don't want to watch this movie anymore. And she turned to me, and she's a very stoic Eastern European woman. And she put her hands on her hips, and she said, so what? You've watched a movie, what, 4 or 5 times? What's the big deal? And I said, more like 400 or 500. And she said, you can't even count that high. I said, yeah, you're right, but I don't want to watch the movie regardless. But if not for this torture, this horrible concentration of movies every single day, I wouldn't know this song, I wouldn't know this music. So for my grandmother, this is Somewhere Over the Rainbow. The clouds are far behind me, where troubles...
When I was 19, I was on a bicycle and I was hit by a car.
Deep within the corners of my mind,
I remember trying to get up,
And nothing happened.
I'm haunted by your smile.
I was faced with the possibility of being paralyzed from the waist down.
As it promises me joy, like a journey to a tropic eye.
They didn't believe that I couldn't move because they didn't know. Like, they couldn't see what was causing my inability to move yet. There were still many tests to be done. And at that moment, I looked at my hands, and then I thought, well, at least I have my hands. And, you know, that was all that mattered to me. I was an art student, and I played piano, but my life was in my fingers. And you know, from the waist down was just like, oh, I'd get a really cool wheelchair or something. You know, with these things you think.
It's not hard to see what you do to me is like a page right out of Ernest Hemingway.
As a young person, you know, to be stripped of all of these things which you were in your former self, you know, someone who walked, someone who ran, someone who rode a bicycle, to have them all taken away from you is to have your identity stripped down to the bare bones essence of who you are as a human being. And so the journey was long.
Though I try to fight all the words you write, leave me standing in the starring row in some tragic lover's play.
Having no desire to take medicine anymore, I'd gotten very sick. And I decided that I would rather have pain than have medicine leave me in a state where I was unable to process things healthfully. The doctor said, hold on a second, he said, what did you used to do before the accident? My mom was there, and she said she used to play piano in piano bars. And his eyes just lit up, and he said, you have to do music.
Deep within the corners of my mind.
And those words began the journey that I've been on since.
I'm haunted by your smile as it promises me joy, like a journey to a tropic island. It's not hard to see what you do to me is like a page right